Yeah, we're rolling.
We consider the Jews to be a racial, an ethnic group of the Caucasian race, which is, we do not classify as white. They are a race and not a religion, again, I can say. They are more a race of the mind, I think, than of their physical appearance. And sometimes it makes it more difficult to detect them.
I don't see how we could possibly have mobilized people on the extent that we have without the swastika, because the people know that we are sincere. They've been betrayed so many times by conservatives and other black clubs, but by flying the swastika, they know that there's no turning back. Once you put that on your arm, you're dedicated. There's no way you can get out of it. And this is a sincerity that we have to convey to our people.
The First Amendment says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech, and that means no law. Now, the problem is that you're defining speech. When you're defining speech is to determine when does speech become action. We only represent people who are engaged in peaceful activity. That doesn't mean it's not going to offend somebody. Everybody has words, can say words that are going to offend somebody else.
White power newspaper right here. We don't want niggers for neighbors. No way. Get your white power paper out today.
We're not just a street gang out here. We're a legitimate, bona fide political party. We've run candidates all over the country. I myself, in 1976, ran for mayor of Milwaukee. And I ran as an open national socialist under the swastika. All my literature had the swastika on it.
Come on, folks. White Power News. How about it, ma'am? White Power News?
You don't represent this community. I do. I'm a family man with little kids that go to Marquette Park. You don't speak for Marquette Park.
We're here.
You're here. You're here because there are people standing in back of you, like me. You understand that?
You're doing a hell of a job of standing in back of us, aren't you?
And I'll stand in front of you, too. How's that?
I can't figure this guy out. Whose side is he on?
Whose side is who on?
Are you on the side of white people or not?
I'm on the side of somebody that believes in people. And I'm not talking about black, Jew, or whatnot.
Oh, a nigger lover.
You understand? Is that what you want to call me? That's all right, buddy.
Hey, keep it down over there. We got an interview going here.
On June 22nd, 1978, Frank Collin announced that the city of Chicago had granted him a permit to rally in Marquette Park, thereby defusing the Skokie confrontation. The Nazis would therefore hold a victory rally in Federal Plaza in downtown Chicago on June 24th, and a rally in Marquette Park on July 9th.
An idea that the First Amendment, which is a good amendment, was passed at a time when the Founding Fathers, I'm sure Jefferson is rolling over in his grave, because it was passed at a time when it meant for free people to gather at their little town halls and discuss the issues of their day. But I think that the death camps in Europe during the period 1939 to 1945 was a pivotal event in this century, and it changed the whole thing. And so we have to be careful about giving people the right to come out in public and organize for purposes of genocide and race hate.
Okay. All right, Frank, you go straight back and get that extension card.
Okay, we'll
get
back
in the container.
Look at the size of the crowd.
That's a good size crowd.
Where's our banners? I don't see them. But I don't know where our men are. I can't see our banners.
It's
I don't know where
behind
they are.
Those police somewhere.
Oh, shit.
That people understand that we have shown up and we have given them publicity, but by doing that we've shown it up to the public, we've made it come out into the open, and in this way people are more aware that it exists, that we should be prepared to oppose it, and hopefully our courts and our legislatures will rise to the occasion, draw the necessary laws, it will be found constitutional by our courts.
Although we did lose an enormous number of members, I think about a quarter of our national membership, I think that those were people who simply didn't understand that we stand for a principle which is indivisible and that we don't stand for an ideology. And really our defense of the Nazis did it more than anything else, showed people that we were not some captive left-wing group, that we represent anybody who's engaged in peaceful activity of speech or parading. And we have slowly rebuilt our membership from people who understand that this is a very essential principle if we're to keep our democracy.
To me, it was never a Jewish issue, even though I feel hurt and I probably emotionally feel pretty bad when I see the Nazis in headlines and on television and read about them. They don't have to come to the streets of Skokie for me to feel hurt and to be reminded of what happened during Nazism. That's enough that I read about it, and it's just as bad. So to me, it wasn't just a march in Skokie. It was a march any place in the United States or the world.
The reason, at least what we believe, and they have conjectured some on this, to why the Nazis or the SS Action Group came to Norwood, the gentleman who, again, runs them here in Norwood is James Roberts, head of the SS Action Group, and he's originally from Lebanon, Ohio, which, you know, unofficially, I guess, is a local KKK hub. There was a former, I believe, a former Grand Dragon or whatever they call their Grand Poobah, who lived up that way, and it's a local center for the KKK, and he said that his background was with them and that he came down here because of GM and Norwood closing. He knew that there would be disgruntled workers, they would be of the middle class and lower middle class, they would essentially be not well educated, meaning not educated in arts and literature, not college educated. Most of them are people who've worked with their hands, machinists, and what they would try to do is they'd try to draw class lines. They would say, here are the downtrodden, uneducated worker who's being tromped on by the Jew, the red man, the black, the educated, who are telling them that they're white and they're middle class, and they're being put in the back, and the blacks and Jews are being put to the forefront in favor of them, and their jobs are being taken away from them by these Jews, by these blacks, by these educated liberal people. Essentially, what they were trying to do was create a schism, and they thought they had here a large pull to do that with. I think one thing they didn't reckon with is that they're also dealing in Norwood with, I guess the right word is an old-fashioned community. There are a lot of values here that when you watch Wally and the Beaver, you can find those same values in Norwood. Norwood is a homey community. This community grew up during the 40s and 50s. And the values are still there in a lot of these people. And you mentioned the word Nazi to them, and they think of one man and one war and something they're never willing to put up with again. These Nazis came under another guise. Maybe they'd be more successful. But coming under the guise of Nazism, they gained no friends in Norwood.
Our organization chose Ann Arbor to conduct the anti-communist rally for the reason that the University of Michigan, for the last, shall we say, 8 years, has been plagued by numerous communist organizations. Our organization right now, we do have a lot of younger people for the simple reason is that they cannot get a decent education in schools because of the black crime rate. They cannot get any type of job, so they come to us for help and information.
6 million lives of the Holocaust, well, we of the SS Action Group believe that it never taken place, because you had, you had Jews dying in World War II of extermination, it was people dying of typhus, diseases, hunger, starvation. Sure, you had a couple of people maybe knocking them around, but as far as we don't believe in the gas chambers or Jews, in fact, getting made out of bars of soap, lampshades, etc., we believe that it never taken place because there were food shortages back then and everything. 6 million Jews did not get exterminated. So far, we haven't found no evidence as far as the Jews exterminated because they just can't prove it. You don't find them digging up bones. You don't find them, you know, holding museums with lampshades. You don't find all that. It's like a secret. They don't bring it out to the public. We never seen a bar of soap made out of a Jew or a lampshade made out of someone's thigh or nothing like that.
This is a book about the Holocaust in Germany that occurred. And you state that you don't believe, your organization does not believe this happened. How would you react to these pictures?
Well, these pictures, they don't look like they've been more or less, you know, brutally tortured. You can see most of them starvation. Well, the victims that are scattered together, they're more or less, they're just burying them. Like I say, some died from diseases, starvation. They're just getting them out the way, I believe.
Why is it that you don't believe this occurred?
Well, the Jews, they've been covering up a lot of things throughout the past, and to me, they're just, you know, big liars. So, like I say, sure, some of it happened, but not, you know, they touched up a lot to make the German folk look real, you know, like they're just insane, you know.
Thank you. thing that's really sad is that now there's this affirmation of human dignity rally, and it's put on by all kinds of interfaith groups and community groups, and only a handful of people are staying for that, which is the most positive thing to come out of the whole thing. And everyone else marched off to City Hall, and they're just dispersing. They had their fun. They saw a few eggs thrown and some rocks, and the police lining up in a phalanx to protect the Nazis, and now big show's all over. And what comes out of it? A lot of nothing, I think.
I think Ann Arbor is one of the most humane places in the country, and better to have such confrontation here than most places. And we will survive, I'm sure of that.
I'm having trouble hearing you. Any other statements you'd like to make about what's happened here or what you stick up for?
Well, I think the major thing, the message that has to come across is that young people especially have to do some reading and thinking about what Nazism meant. I find it almost inconceivable that anybody would identify with a Nazi movement. Yeah, anybody. Unless they're just plain deranged. And it was such a horrible period in history that for anybody to say that they want to be like that, I just find to be incomprehensible.
Yeah. That is top work, huh? Lucy?
I'm ready. traditional scapegoats in American society have been first and foremost Black American, but also women and also Jews. When we look, for example, at some of the utterances of Ku Klux Klan leaders, what we see are persons who rightly perceive the decline in the standard of living. They rightly perceive cultural decay and deterioration. But they then move in traditionally racist American modes and attempt to ascribe this to the very people who not only are on the bottom of the social ladder, but are the people who have less access to resources, less power than any other people in the society. It's not only it's logically inconsistent, but it's practically incredible. It's hard to believe. But I think what we actually have oftentimes in the Ku Klux Klan are a group of white persons who themselves have been victimized. Now, I know it might seem a bit far-fetched to talk about the Ku Klux Klan being composed in part of victims, but they actually are. They're actually very poor white workers trying to make sense of a situation in which their skin serves as one of the only sources of meaning and significance to them. They do know that big business has not contributed to their welfare. This is why the Ku Klux Klan has a populist slant to it. See? But they think that if somehow they control Black people, either by terrorism or by law, that they will be able to move up the social ladder. But there's no evidence for it. See? Why? Because that social ladder is in no way controlled by Black people. Black people, for the most part, are at the bottom of the social ladder. That social ladder is actually much more in the hands of the big business who the Klan ought to be criticizing, along with myself.
In 1977, two former Mississippi Klan leaders, E.L. McDaniels, ex-Grand Dragon of the United Klans of America, and his treasurer, L.C. Murray, met here with Mayor Charles Evers in Fayette, Mississippi. They met at our request. All have changed a great deal in the last decade. Mayor Evers, brother of Medgar, became the first Black elected to public office in Mississippi. Since McDaniels and Murray left the Klan, they have joined with the mayor in his fight for civil rights.
And these here two men were my strongest enemies, and I have no question about that. I was their strongest enemy. And we used to fight in the streets together. We used to fight each other, we used to harass each other, and intimidate each other. And I don't know what happened to all the three of us, but I think somewhere along the line we realized that we were the same kind of folk.
I have been out of the Klan since September the 6th, 1966. I have had several calls, many calls I might add, over the years, wanting me to come back into Klan, organize the Klan, and I have turned them down each time. I personally do not think it's time for that.
When McDaniels was Grand Dragon, the Mississippi Klans boasted 80,000 members.
Might as well be honest. At that time, I joined the Klan because I felt that integration was wrong.
My four children will never go to school with these goatee Black African jungle bunnies as long as I'm walking on my two feet.
But people didn't know how or what to do. And so the Klan come into existence, and the people flocked to it.
In other words, the Klan had to answer all of the poor white people's problems.
Right.
The Klan.
That's exactly right. Like the NAACP was to solve all the problems of the Black. Well, it wasn't no way that the NAACP could solve all problems. Neither could the Klan solve all problems. Maybe if we'd got together back then, we could have solved the problem.
But
I don't know.
The difference was that the NAACP meant the advancement of people and not the denial.
Right.
Or the Klan meant to deprive.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have never heard me, before an audience or in secret, advocating or condone violence in any way. But is it violence when our communities are jeopardized by such sex-crazed, idiotic mobs as the Deacons or the NAACP, Kofo, SNCC, or Loco, or whatever you call them?
The word Klans meant to harass, intimidate, and actually destroy anything that's different. Ku Klux Klan stood for violence, For murder, for all the inhuman things.
Well,
as they used to ride, the night riders, you know, they ride at night and burn schools and all that kind of old silly stuff
you
used to
long time. Well, you go back to 1866 in Pulaski, Tennessee, when the Klan was organized. It was to harass and intimidate the blacks.
That's it. That's the whole thing.
One thing I can say for every white man that dies at the hand of these filthy mobs, there are going to be hundreds of those no good, goatee looking African jungle bunnies that's going to go down in the street.
I was confused along with a lot of others. I think the people have been educated. I'm speaking of Mississippi now. I think the people have been educated in the state over the past years and seen the progress that been made by just Mayor Evers and I and Lane being friends and many other Klan people that are his friend, that I think that the Klan won't go in Mississippi. I think they have a hard time organizing.
That they're different, right? They're lazy, you know? You just can't depend on them. Well, as far as I'm concerned, they haven't been in civilization a long time, you know? But look, we have a very nice community. I mean, we have a good church-going community, and we want to keep it that way. Look, anybody's welcome. I mean, if they're the right type. But I just don't want to hang around with them. I can't help it.
I can't help it. That's how I am. And they look funny. I mean, not like us. And they pray funny, too. Those others, well, they don't dress well and they throw garbage everywhere, then they try to be your friend.
The subtle poison of prejudice passed almost innocently from parent to child. We have statistics on polio, but not on the number of children crippled by prejudice, a disease where parents are one of the main sources of infection. No antibiotic can cure hatred. You can. Don't infect your children with prejudice.
Ask my father. He'll tell you what's really true.
DVD.
America cannot tell the truth about herself. If the history of this country were written, you would have to say that this country is a nation of thieves. It began by stealing this country from the red man. If I said to you that Christopher Columbus discovered America in 1492, you would say, that's correct. But now here come this honky from Spain. They're already non-white people here, and they're not existing until he comes and discovers them. Ain't that something?
Well, you got to look at racism from an Indian point of view and why there's racism towards Indians. There's many different forms of racism, but basically the racism that exists towards Indians in this country has to do with land-based reasons, economic reasons. 1% of America's land base is American Indian land. Over 60% of America's natural energy resources are on that 1% of land. So therefore, there's a big push to take that land away from Indian people.
One of the most hurtful things about the racism that Indian people feel is that we're treated like we don't exist, like we are historical objects. It's safer, it's more convenient for the American governments, the state governments, and the people to believe that Indians don't exist now and that we're only, you can only find us in museums or in Hollywood movies because of the reality of the land. And ever since the first Europeans came to this country, the issue has been the land. And so today we have treaties and agreements with the government that aren't honored, and we have the stereotypes that have been pushed in the public school systems and in the Hollywood movies and on TV of this, of either the stoic noble savage or the squaw, the woman as the drudge who did all the work, or the chief. But it's all yesterday. None of it's today. And I think it's a real dangerous sort of racism because it's so subtle.
On December 7th, 1941, Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor by air. February of 1942, President Franklin D. Roosevelt declared the West Coast a military zone. All Japanese residents, American citizens or not, were ordered out and placed in relocation camps.
Before World War II, Japanese people lived together just like Chinatown.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason was because American government didn't allow them to buy land. So back then, Japanese are living their own style, eating their own food. It made American people scared some part. It's just because strange, you know, and also it's their enemies. The reason was they thought there would be some espionage, you know, Japanese going to be a traitor during World War II, because Japanese was the enemy to the United States. So even though loyal citizens, American-born Japanese people, they are also sent to a camp, which really hurt their, in their life, there are a lot of scars remained economically and also psychologically. So after the war, everybody warned, including the government, don't get together, scattered, become invisible as possible. Otherwise, you'll be another target.
I was walking down the street from my girlfriend's house, and I seen some guys across the street over there. And, you know, one guy, older guy, was checking a young guy's head, you know, because blood was running down his face. And I went over to see if they needed any help. They said they needed some help, and they was going to offer me $20 to catch these Chinese guys that they got into it with. So I said, okay. I said, do y'all want to go to the hospital? Because it was right around the corner. So we got into their car. father was saying, you know, when we catch up with these Chinese guys, we're going to bust their motherfucking heads like that. And as we got up to McDonald's, father seen the two Chinese guys sitting down. And I told them that the police was there. They said, fuck the police.
At which time they jumped out and it kind of shocked me. And because it's a predominantly 90% black neighborhood, and to see a male white get out of a car with a baseball bat, the first thing I was thinking that maybe it was a coming from the Tiger Stadium baseball game.
Mr. Evans and Mr. Nitz jumped out from behind the truck, attempted to grab Vincent Chin, who they cornered up in the phone booth here.
Mr. Nitz had to grab Mr. Vincent Chin in a bear hug while Mr. Evans swung a bat, repeatedly striking Mr. Chin.
Evidently, Mr. Chin broke loose. He ran out here to the middle of the street, and he stopped. He slipped. Mr. Evans was standing over him with a baseball bat. He had it with both hands, and he was hitting him in the top of his head.
He swung the bat as if a baseball player was swinging for a home run, full contact, full swing.
Well, the legend of Vincent Chin was probably best explained by Elizabeth when she came home from school. She's 8 years old. She's in the second grade at that time, she was, and said, I found out what the Vincent Chin case is all about. She said, that's the case, my substitute teacher told me, where the auto worker who was out of work was so mad that he beat up this Chinese guy because he thought he was Japanese.
And right there on the front page was coverage of that these two killers had received probation for killing a Chinese man. And I just felt all of the blood and feeling in my body leave me. I just couldn't believe that this had happened.
Being asked if justice failed somewhere in this case, I don't see anywhere it did fail. I think the system worked the way it should have worked, right down the line.
Between 1920 and 1930, there was only one Klan in America, and it had clout. Klan membership peaked in 23 at 9 million. One out of every 8 American men, including governors, senators, mayors, and sheriffs. Gaudy ceremonial regalia, mass initiations, and cross burnings guaranteed media coverage. Propaganda films and inflammatory rhetoric were used to organize Klan units across the country. Staggering inflation and unemployment were the issues used to draw in new recruits who could scapegoat their frustrations by blaming the Catholic immigrant and the Jewish financier. The Klan's tactics were violent. Anyone who was considered different could be branded an enemy of the Klan.
The American white people are searching and are reaching out for a movement to carry forth their ideals and their values, the dreams that they carry in their hearts. And the Ku Klux Klan is that movement.
David Duke, born in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1950, educated at Louisiana State. He became a member of the Louisiana-based Knights of the KKK in the early 70s. In 74, he became Imperial Wizard and National Director of this Klan, which is estimated to have about 1,000 members nationwide. In 75, Duke ran for the Louisiana State Senate as an avowed Klansman.
We need a voice for our heritage, ideals, and interests. It's only fair if things are to be evened up a bit.
We do need a real voice for the majority. Let's elect David Duke, Senator, District 16.
Oh, I think he's the greatest. They don't come any better. He's great in every way. And if he loses, it'll be a crying shame, believe me.
One plant, only 15.
Duke plans his strategy with campaign manager Tom Metzger. They used the media carefully in the campaign, and Duke went directly to the people with his Klan message.
I think two guys
okay.
will cover it.
All right, then let's just forget everything I said about the other and follow this up here.
We're going to stand proudly and honestly and courageously, and we're not going to stop until we win. Thank you.
Duke lost the state Senate race to a strong incumbent. However, he received over 11,000 votes, one-third of all votes cast in a well-educated urban district.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say of
Metzger
the Lord,
and his wife joined the Klan when Duke opened membership to Catholics and to women. Dennis Campbell, military attaché, was a Klan organizer in the Marine Corps. Kathy Metzger, Klan state secretary, helps her husband with his work, as do their children.
Will I satisfy him and show him my salvation? Amen.
All right, gang, dig in.
I suppose we can't mess the cheese up on top of it.
No, you have to get to the bottom.
This is a real farmhouse table, guys. They are taught about race all the time.
We do like our children to be around other children whose parents feel the same way that they do.
You know, a lot of people think we hate the blacks. We don't hate them, we just don't care for them, you know. They don't care for us, usually. Yeah, but we do hate the Jews, and they hate us.
You may remember this. That's you. Yeah, that's me. Okay.
That's amazing, David.
Was
yes,
it?
The Chicago
it's State. Not amazing. All right, I was young.
You still sell the Nazi literature.
Well, I sell books on all sorts of subjects, but I don't sell Nazi literature as such.
You don't?
No.
The Nameless War, Mein Kampf, Hitler Was My Friend, Germany's Hitler, The Testimony of Adolf Hitler, The Hitler We Loved and Why, UFOs, Nazi Secret Weapon, My Part in Germany's Fight, Dr. Joseph Goebbels.
We sell a long book list, and you're picking out a few of them.
Okay,
and
I
we
can
do,
read the
wait,
others.
We do believe that there should be a... You see, this interview is exactly what I was talking about before. It's a totally negative thing. You're just trying to get me to respond to all these different things.
Well, I am.
And that's all it is. I mean, it's nothing about what we're doing, our philosophy, our ideals.
That's
what
exactly
we're trying to,
what it's
No,
about.
It's not either, because you're picking out something from a long time ago. You're picking out something, a few books that we sell, and you're distorting it. And you're going to make the people out there think that we're Nazis, and we're not. And you don't damn well we're not. We're Klansmen.
Well, what is this picture, David? That, it's you. This is you.
What now?
Well, you are selling these things.
I feel like that Jesus can deliver them from that perverted spirit.
In your ministry, what's your stance on homosexuals?
Homosexuality is not of God. It's an unnatural act. It's not a natural act. And God can deliver the homosexual.
The Klan is marching in Atlanta for the first time in 40 years. Tomorrow in Atlanta, and we're trying to organize people to come out and show them the welcome they deserve.
America for America. America is a white, Christian, English-speaking, anti-communist people of Northern European descent. God bless America.
What about the AIDS crisis?
Yes, we have a platform on AIDS. We don't want to see someone laying in a hospital, elderly, with cancer, diabetes, and wondering if they're going to be cured or the money's going to go down the rat hole of AIDS research. The lesson to come out of the AIDS epidemic is be compassionate, but also outlaw homosexuality and perversion in America.
So I understand you hate gays, but what about...
I don't hate anybody. No. I just love America.
Fight back! Fight AIDS! Act up! Fight back! Fight AIDS! Act up!
Are you in favor of violence to fight for your cause?
I'm going to do violence to this homosexual paper right here. That's how I feel about homosexuals. That's how I feel about special interests. That's how I feel about those who oppress the majority of the American people.
We are not going to be intimidated by these people or any other reactionary group.
Racist, sexist, anti-gay, we say no to the KKK.
When we do not define ourselves and speak up for who we are, by using a disability, other people define ourselves, and we've seen that, but we've also seen what happens when we speak out for who we are as gay men and lesbians, and that's what we have to start doing. We've been polite for 7 years. We must demand our rights, not ask for them. There has not been a single group in this country that's been oppressed that has been given their rights. We must demand them.
No Nazis! No KKK! No racist USA!
No Nazis! No KKK, no racist.
Look at this faggot right there. We're going to put the pink triangles on again, too.
Yeah, come on up to New York. We'll see what you can do.
Praise God for AIDS! Praise God for AIDS!
A bunch of faggots trying to run our country, getting their diseases in our country. We don't need it, because we don't need everything. They're giving it to everybody else, innocent. People.
Included of a poster of a Klansman in full uniform with the hoods and everything that said, kill you queer, we want you gays to die. And that is why I'm here, and I'm happy to see that the lesbian gay community was out here today to join us to say no to the Klan and their bigotry.
I don't hate those folks across the street, but I promise you this, we may be like David. We're going to have a victory over that Goliath, and our love is going to conquer the hatred of the communists against the American people. Thank you.
White power! White power! White power!
People power!
Can I have your attention just a moment? That is not in the best interest of the city of Atlanta to allow the Klan to march in Atlanta.
Yeah!
No KKK!
The Klan will be advised that if they attempt to march on the streets of the city of Atlanta, they will be arrested.
Maxine and Maria had asked me to come to the kiss-in, and I did, and so then the police started getting really upset that we were there, and we weren't doing anything except kissing each other on the street, and so then the police started moving everyone back, and at that point, I crossed the street to the other side because I thought, gee, that's enough for me this weekend, and I have a limit, and this is the limit, and then I watched what they were doing to everyone else that stayed in the group. And I sort of did this whole thing in my head for about 5 minutes, and then I thought, well, I probably do have a limit, but my limit is not this, and I need to go back over there and help them out, so I did. And it's just a real high the first time you do that, and I'm sure it's a high every time you do it, because we can't be silent about stuff, and they don't have any right to do that at all, and we did exactly what was appropriate.
Powerfully and forcefully in America. This is the beginning of the resurrection of a new America.
We get your name, sir?
Richard Barrett.
B-A-R-R?
Yes, sir. I'm the speaker and the lawyer for the National Movement.
Mr. Barrett,
We want to drive the homosexuals back into their closet. We want to drive the Black Power gang out of power and special privileges. And we want to have the misfits in society relegated to the lowest. We want America for Americans, where the majority rules, not the minorities. Where there's justice for all, but favors for none. That's the message of real Americanism. We're not the favored few. We're the majority of Americans, and we are the American people.
So I was targeted as a black extremist, and put into the United States government's agitated index file, their key extremist file, and a number of other files, black nationalist photo album. And these files were basically designed to identify and target certain leaders and spokesmen of the African-American struggle for human rights, so that they could be neutralized and otherwise taken out of circulation. The analogies abound. I mean, like, you know, I hate to keep going back to this war on drugs, but, you know, that's the same thing as the old law and order ruse from the 60s. I mean, the term law and order, when the ghettos were going up in flames, when black people were marching in the streets, when fists were being thrust in the air demanding black power, the term law and order meant keep the niggas in their place. That's basically what the term meant. Keep these black folks in their place. And they would present, you know, images of these enraged black youth on the screens and scare white America to death. And they would, and during the 6 o'clock news, they would show a phalanx of Black Panthers, everybody looking serious and appropriately gruesome, you know, and wearing black and black berets and scare white folks to death. Don't they do the same thing when it comes to Iran? Don't they show you a picture of millions of Iranians chanting death to America, and then they flash to a Marines barracks that was blown up in Beirut, or they flash to Ronald Reagan when he was the Grand Poobah, the Grand Dragon, they flash to him, right? Don't they? So everybody says, well, Iranians are crazy, they hate us. So therefore, when Iranians are murdered, as in the Airbus incident, no one deals with their humanity. The first thing you have to do in order to oppress a people, to repress them, is to denigrate their humanity. Reduce them to something less than human. Make them into an other, a threatening other. And you could do anything you wanted to them. You could lock them up and put them in prison like they did me. You could murder them like they did Fred Hampton and Mark Clark, or Twyman Myers, or Zaid Malik Shakur. Or you could exile them like they did Michael Tabor or Asada Shakur. You see? That's what the system does. It first strips you of your humanity, reduces you to the level of a mad dog and a depraved terrorist. And then it's open season on you. They can do anything they want to you.
What does the government fear of people like Daruba Moore getting out?
Oh, they fear Daruba Moore because he's articulate. He will get an audience. He's been on many programs already. People will listen to him. He has shown the system to be crooked and criminal, and he's pushing to get a new trial. He wants a new trial. The government would be wise not to give him one, but he wants one where he can show a jury now really what happened to him and how they took away 19 years of a man's life, and no one will go to jail for that. The true criminals will never go to jail, the ones who suppressed the evidence that led to taking away most of his adult manhood.
We'll be right back. So part Jewish, part Catholic, part Buddhist. I am Swedish.
This is America if you're full of brotherly love. If you're full of brotherly hate, this is what America will become. Prejudice is something America can live without.